to the Fellowship of Cambridge Drive Community Church. The Via Positiva, or the Positive Path, today, as we celebrate communion, the bread and the wine, the flesh and the blood of Jesus the Christ, to unite us with the universe, to unite us with his creation. I invite you to take 30 seconds of your time to pause and to have a time of silence and meditation with me. Let's do that now. Loving and compassionate Father, Papa of love, who offers restoration in all things through the victory of Jesus the Christ, we are here together again to worship you. We open ourselves. We want to listen to your voice in us and around us, inviting to partake of your grace so that we might become like Jesus, so that compassion and cooperation might abound among us here and around the world. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. From now on, I'm going to be making a little pause at the moment that you can play your music and participate in worship. Our first scripture reading is found in the book of Psalms, chapter 8, verses 1 to 5. And it reads, from the NRSV, Divine Majesty and Human Dignity, a Psalm of David. O Lord, our Sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouths of babes and infants, you have founded a bulwark because of your foes to silence the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you have established, what are human beings that you are mindful of them, mortals, that you care for them? Yet you have made them a little lower than God and crowned them with glory and honor. Our second scripture reading is found in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. If my people who are called by my name humble themselves, pray, seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and heal their land, heal their soil. Last week, we concluded that the invitation to the path of joy, the Via Positiva, we are invited to dwell deeply on the book of Genesis, that cosmology that affirms that God's creation is actually good. God made every kind of wildlife, every kind of livestock, and every kind of creature that crawls on the ground. God saw how good it was. Today, I invite you to consider a return to joy. And by the way, I want to clarify that last week I mispronounced the word ah because I was reading it in Spanish. So I could say my Spanish interference. But today, I return to joy and awe of the mystery of life. In our day, we have lost a sense of joy. There seems to be very little to celebrate. The situation in Afghanistan, the crisis, Haiti, the damages caused by Hurricane Ida, and the fires not too far from us. The media seems to be colonized by bad news, instilling fear and insecurity in many people. In the passage of 2 Chronicles that we have today, chapter 7, verse 14, there is a suggestion of a path, the via positiva, a way towards healing and restoration of joy. It states that the reconnection with God requires humbleness on our part. Humbleness is then indeed necessary. But the verse is revelatory. It goes beyond that. It implies more than just humbleness. It implies that we are all connected because it affirms that the reconnecting with God means to also find the joy of forgiveness and the healing of the soil, which means that salvation is not just individual. Salvation, our salvation, our well-being, our joy will affect also the community. We cannot experience salvation alone. We experience salvation in the community and for the community. This mystical unity that we find in this verse in particular is the union of the humankind, the union of God, and the union of the soil, or the cosmos. It is indeed profound and mystical. Sometimes it escapes the analytical abilities. It requires experiencing with our whole being. In his book, The Rhythm of Being, by theologian Raymond Panikkar, he cites a Sufi poem that invites our minds to dive into the mystery of life. And this poem says, God sleeps in the stones. He breathes in the plants. He dreams in the animals and awakens in man. Raymond Panikkar, in his book, The Rhythm of Being, invites us to the mystical experience as God sleeps in the stones, breathes in the plants, dreams in the animals, and awakens in man. Why is this so important that we recover the joy of life in our hearts? Eco-theologian Thomas Berry reminds us, the naive assumption that the natural world is there to be possessed and used by humans for the advantage and in the unlimited manner cannot be accepted, he says. Instead, he admonishes us, education and religion especially should awaken to the young an awareness of the world in which they live, how it functions, how the human fits into the larger community of life, the role that the human fulfills in the great story of the universe, and the historical sequence of developments that have shaped our physical and cultural landscape. Along with this awareness of the past and present, education and religion should communicate some guidance concerning the future. And also, he admonishes us, speaking about religion and education. Both education and religion, he says, needs to ground themselves with the story of the universe. As we know it through an empirical ways of knowing, within this functional cosmology, we can overcome our alienation and being the renewal of life on a sustainable basis. This story is a numinous revelatory story that could evoke not only the vision, but also the energies needed for bringing ourselves and the entire planet into a new order of survival. As humans, often we find ourselves dwelling too long in self-pity rather than welcoming the task of sustainability and survival. We must welcome joy again. That is the invitation of 2 Chronicles 7:14. Re-engage again with God. Reconnect again with joy. Let it take over our experience of life. Fear is the other option. But fear restricts us. Fear pushes us down, paralyzes us. Joy is from God, and thus we are moved to share. Notice, we cannot hoard joy. Joy moves us to companionship. The experience of joy must be shared. It cannot be saved for later. It cannot be hoarded. Love and joy go together. That is why Matthew Fox, the theologian we've been studying through the Via Positiva, path of joy, and Via Negativa, Via Creativa, and Via Transformativa, these four ways are really coming from Matthew Fox. He says the following: joy is what leads us humans to fight for justice, he says, to die for a noble cause. Justice is not an end in itself, but joy is. And this means that joy is the fountain of zest to keep transforming evil into blessings. Joy will lead us back to community, to seek company and support, then to keep focused despite the pain and sorrows we must encounter when we seek to do justice and live well. Joy brings us together because whatever happens to my neighbor, whether joy or suffer or sorrow, it also happens to me. We all are connected. Do you see the connection in this passage? If the people that are called by his name, if the people who are called to educate the young, if my people who feel the pain and the sorrow of our society are connected with me, God says, you then will receive the blessing of joy. And the blessing of joy will push us out to care for our community, because joy needs to be shared. My choosing of joy will connect me back to God and with my community, because I will get joy back. And we are promised that even the soil will be healed. In our days, this passage and this verse in particular, in my opinion, it's rather inspirational. If my people called by my name humble themselves, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, and then what would happen is that God will be connected again with us. The joy will return to our hearts. Our sin will be forgiven. We will experience the joy, and our land will be healed as well. The experience of joy returns when we realize how connected we are and how powerful our choices are. My joy, like I said before, affects you, your joy, and my choice of dwelling too long in sorrow will also affect my community as well and the universe. Thomas Berry again reminds us in this idea of community that the universe is composed of subjects to be commuted with no objects to be exploited. In other words, the rest of the universe must be perceived by our hearts with joy, because this joy makes us connected with the creation of God, which is alive, subjects, not objects. Everything has its own voice. The thunder, lightning, and the stars, the planets, flowers, the birds, the animals, the trees, all these have voices, and they constitute a community of existence that is profoundly related. Unquote. The natural world is the largest sacred community to which we belong. To be alienated from this community is to become destitute in all that makes us human. To damage this community is to diminish our own existence. In conclusion, a return to joy is a return to God. It's the metanoia of Jesus, to repent, to go back, to reconnect with God. To return to God is to find joy, to recover the awe of life and become one with the diversity, the great diversity of this beautiful universe. When we look at the heavens, as we read before, the works of God, fingers, the moon, and the stars that he has established, what are human beings that you are mindful, we ask God. Yet you made us a little lower than gods and crowned us with glory and honor. God, the mystery of the universe. Sometimes we want to get rid of the mystery. But like Panikkar says, if we work out one way of take away the mystery of the universe, we might be in danger of taking ourselves and disappear with that mystery. So the mystery of the universe sleeps in the stone, the stones, the pebbles, the mountains. God sleeps in the stones. He breathes in the plants, dreams in the animals, and awakens in us. That is our everlasting fountain of joy. This, my brothers and sisters, is the word of God for all the people. Glory be to God. Amen. And now we will celebrate communion. Vietnamese monk Thich Nhat Hanh says, "Take my friends, this is my flesh, and this is my blood." And he says, "Can there be any more drastic language in order to wake you up? What could Jesus have said that is better than that? This piece of bread is the body of the whole cosmos. If Christ is the body of God, which he is, then the bread he offers is also the body of the cosmos. Look deeply, and you notice the sunshine in the bread, the blue sky in the bread, the cloud and the great earth in the bread. Can you tell me what is not in a piece of bread? He says, the whole cosmos have come together in order to bring to you this piece of bread. You eat it in such a way that you can come alive, truly alive. God sleeps in the stones. God brings us life. God is with us. So my brothers and sisters, I invite you to remember that Jesus, the day when he celebrated this special event that connects us with the universe, he broke the bread and said, this is my flesh that is being given for you so that we might receive the blessing of reconnecting with the Father. And I, as a minister of the church, I invite you, let us eat. And after they ate, he took the cup and he said, this is the cup of the new covenant that represents my blood. Do this in remembrance of me. And remember, we are united with Christ. We are united with the cosmos, with God, with creation. Let us drink. And after they ate, they sang a song. So I'll pause for a second and you can play the music and then we'll do the benediction. Let us pray. Father of all life around us, Father, who in every moment continue to call us to healing, as your spirit continues to hover over all of us, inviting us to set free our spirits and to become prophets of our time. May we, your church, your community, remember that in the kingdom of God, in your kingdom, healing is already happening. As a direct result of those who you continue to resurrect as prophets of our days. May the Spirit of God inspire us to advocate for transformational change, justice, and healing in ourselves, in our families, in our communities, so that we all might return to joy, to the via positiva. In Jesus the Christ, his name we pray. Amen. Peace be with you.